Thank you, Yannick. And first of all, I would like to thank the scientific committee for inviting me to do this talk today, and Belén for the beautiful clinical overview of NBIA. So as you have heard, NBIA is a heterogeneous progressive neurological condition that is characterized by iron accumulation mainly in the basal ganglia. The clinical presentation is relatively different from one form of the other, but brain iron is always present in these patients. This is a rare genetic disorder with a frequency of 1 to 3 for 1 million of people, with autosomal recessive, dominant, or X-linked inheritance. Several gene mutations result in NBIA. The most frequent is PONK2 gene mutations that result in a PKAN form. But the second is due to mutation to PLE2G6 that define the PLAN, but there is also the COPAN, MPAN, FAHN, etc., etc. But the disease-causing gene has still to be identified for a vast majority of patients. These different genes are involved in different pathways. PONK2 and CoA-C encode key mitochondrial enzyme for the synthesis of coenzyme A. P2G6, C19ORF12, and FE2H are involved in lipid metabolism. WDR45, ATP13A2 are involved in autophagy. Only two of these genes encode proteins clearly involved in iron homeostasis that are FTL and CP that respectively encode ferritin and serinoplasmin. And finally, C2ORF37 encodes a protein of unknown function. Moreover, NBIA has been reported in other patients with mutations in GTPBP2, a gene of unknown function, and in mutations with genes that have been previously reported in association with other clinical presentations, such as DDIHD1, EPI4M1, or PSEN1. So therefore, all of that show you that NBIA results from very different various abnormal pathways. For sure, iron accumulation is a secondary consequence of the primary deficiency, but the common pathway that result in iron homeostasis defect is still completely understood. So this cartoon shows you the various various defects related to NBIA. First of all, of sure, the serinoplasmin and FTL deficiency that are clearly involved in iron homeostasis. PONK2, CoA-C that are related to coenzyme A synthesis. Here you have the phospholipid remodeling, and finally, two genes involve autophagy. So it is clear that the two most common gene mutations, PONK2 and PLATO-G6, as well as other genes such as CoA-C, C19ORF12, and EPI2H, are related directly or indirectly to coenzyme A synthesis and phospholipid remodeling, showing that lipid metabolism impairment is a frequent cause of NBIA. And this is confirmed because we've recently identified novel genes for NBIA in this family, in which this girl, born to consanguineous patients of parents of Turkish origin, had normal pregnancy and delivery. And this disease started when she was 40 months old with speech delay. Then, at 3 years of age, she had progressive cerebellar ataxia and spinocerebellar degeneration. At that time, the metabolic workup was normal, except that we observed elevated very long-chain fatty acid in plasma, and the brain MRI performed at 10 years of age revealed cerebellar atrophy and thickening of the corpus callosum. Only 5 years later, could the brain MRI detect hypo signal of the in the substantia nigra and the globus pallidus that revealed iron deposit. So we perform STIM genotyping and exome sequencing in this family, and this allowed us to identify a homozygous variation in CRAD gene. This variation co-segregates with the disease in the family. It was absent from more than 100 patients, NBIA patients, and from control chromosomes. CRAT encodes the carnitine acetyltransferase, an enzyme involved in coenzyme A biosynthesis, mainly present in mitochondria, but also in peroxisome and endoplasmic reticulum. This arginine, the mutant arginine, is a very conserved residues in the between species and occurs in a highly conserved region of the protein. This arginine is involved in several H bonds with surrounding amino acids, and the modification of this arginine into a histidine will disrupt these H bonds, probably resulting in destabilization of the protein. And indeed, Western blood analysis failed to detect the CRAD protein in fibroblast of the patient. CRAD allows the reversible transfer of acyl-CoA between carnitine and coenzyme A, and therefore modulate the ratio between acetyl-CoA and CoA. We therefore measured the beta oxidation of C16 palmitate in patients' fibroblasts, and we observed a decrease of C2 that showed that there is indeed a beta oxidation defect in patients' fibroblasts. We then overexpressed the wild-type CRAD cDNA in these cells, and this partially rescued the beta-oxidation defect, showing that CRAD mutations are indeed responsible for this beta-oxidation defect, and that CRAD is a disease-causing gene. There is more and more NBAA genes that have been identified thanks to exome sequencing, but the link between this gene mutation and the iron overload is completely not understood. Unfortunately, all the animal models with NBIA gene mutations or defect of these NBIA genes didn't display any iron accumulation. There is a lot of different mouse and Drosophila and zebrafish model, and as you can see, they have very clear phenotypes. Some are really related to the function of the proteins, such as FA2H, for example, but none of them show any iron overload. A lot of cellular models have also been studied with the aim to understand why and how these gene mutations result in impaired iron homeostasis. For example, HeLa cells down-regulated for PONC2, PONC2 fibroblast or iPS-derived neuron with PONC2 mutation have been studied. It appears from these studies that the PONC2 deficient cells have deregulation of cytosolic and mitochondrial iron homeostasis, but the reason for that is completely unknown. CoA-C mutations have been described by the group of Valeria Tiranti that didn't report any abnormal iron homeostasis in CoA-C fibroblasts. But the expression of the mutant protein in a yeast deleted for CAB5 gene, which is the orthologue of CoA-C in human, result in iron overload, suggesting that it is clearly, there is clearly a link between CoA-C mutation and iron homeostasis. Finally, WDR45 is involved in autophagosome formation, and fibroblasts of patients with WDR45 mutations have down-regulation of transferrin receptor and increase of intracellular ferrous iron after starvation, suggesting that autophagosome formation is linked to iron homeostasis. We had the opportunity to identify the family with brain iron accumulation that help us to identify, to understand the link of NBIA gene mutation and iron overload in the brain. So these two sisters, born to parents of French origin, non-consanguineous parents, had a relatively similar clinical presentation. The first girl presented at 80 months of age with speech and motor delay, trunk hypotonia, cerebellar ataxia, and pyramidal syndrome. At 9 years of age, she lost completely the ability to walk. She has dysarthria, dysmetry, and dystagmus, as well as spasticity of lower limbs. The metabolic workup was completely normal, but brain MRI, performed at 15 years of age, showed cerebellar atrophy and also iron deposits in substantia nigra and globus pallidus. So we performed exome sequencing for these two sisters, and this allows us to identify two gene two mutations, heterozygous mutation in RepS1 genes. This mutation co-segregates with the disease in the family, were absent from more than 100 NBIA patients and from control chromosomes. So RepS1 encodes the RALBP1-associated hepsin domain containing one protein. These two amino acids, VAL78 and alanine-113, are located in the conserved region of the protein, that is the hepsin-15 homology domain 1 here that interact with RALBP1. And we looked at the RepS1 amount in fibroblasts of the patients and found a decreased amount of this protein, suggesting that these two mutations affect the stability of the protein. So RepS1 is involved in endocytosis and receptor recycling, and this function can help you to understand the link between iron homeostasis and RepS1 mutation. The major route for iron uptake is transferrin receptor, that is endocytosed at the membrane by a clatrin-dependent internalization. This uncoated vesicle will bind RALBP1, that then recruits RepS1. The acidification of the uncoated vesicle will result in the release of iron into the cytosol, and this iron will partially be stored in the ferritin, in the cytosolic and the mitochondrial ferritin. RepS1 then binds to RAB11-FIB2, and this allows the fusion of the uncoated vesicle and the perinuclear recycling endosome and budding of these multivesicular bodies, which result in the recycling endosome that returns to the membrane and make the transferrin to return to the blood flow. And this will allow also the transferrin recyclum to have transferrin receptor to have a new cycle of transcycling to import a new iron. So we make the hypothesis that RepS1 mutation could modify to induce iron homeostasis by modifying the transferrin receptor recycling and the endosome recycling. Therefore, we measured the iron content in fibroblasts of the patient with RepS1 mutation. And as you can see here, in low iron condition, control and RepS1 fibroblasts have a relatively similar amount of iron. However, when we incubated the fibroblast with ferric ammonium citrate, or FAC, which is a soluble source of iron that induces iron uptake, we observe, obviously, that control cells increase that iron content, but RepS1 fibroblasts have a high level of iron, suggesting that these cells are unable to limit iron entry. We then overexpressed the wild-type RepS1 cDNA in patients' fibroblasts that reduced the iron content that returned to normal values, and this shows us that RepS1 mutations indeed induce iron overload and that RepS1 is the disease-causing gene. We also looked at by oxyblot at the protein oxidation, and as you can see here, we found that the protein of fibroblasts of the patients have an increased protein oxidation, and when grown in high iron condition, we observe a very high increase of protein oxidation that reflect probably the iron overload. Iron has a very important role in a large number of essential cellular functions, such as oxygen transport, mitochondrial energy supply, deoxynucleotide synthesis, or detoxification. But iron also catalyzes the formation of highly reactive reactive radicals that damage DNA and membranes. Therefore, it is extremely important to maintain iron homeostasis to ensure iron supply and to prevent toxic iron accumulation. And before to go further in the study of iron homeostasis in NBIA, I will remind you the regulation of iron homeostasis. This regulation is at the post-transcriptional level and is done by an IRP-IRE system. IRP has iron regulatory proteins, 1 and 2, that binds to iron-responsive elements in 5' or 3' UTR region. So in low iron condition, IRP1 and IRP2 binds in the 3' region of the transferrin receptor region, and this will stabilize the transferrin receptors and therefore increase the iron uptake. In the same time, this IRP binds in the 5' region of the ferritin transcript, and this will hamper the synthesis of ferritin, and therefore that will reduce the iron storage. In high iron condition, IRP1 is converted into aconitase, and IRP2 is degraded. Therefore, this will result in a decrease of TFR1 and an increase of ferritin, and therefore a decreased iron uptake and increased iron storage. In patients in RepS1 fibroblast, we observed a slight increase of transferrin receptor in low iron condition, and instead to decrease in high iron condition, TFR1 increased, and at the same time, ferritin also increased. So this shows you that indeed RepS1 fibroblasts are unable to regulate the iron uptake and have iron overload. The catalase, superoxidase mutase 1 and 2, were relatively increased in low iron condition in RepS1 fibroblast, suggesting an iron overload that results in oxidative stress. And in high iron condition, control cells obviously increase these protections against free radical, but not patients' fibroblasts, suggesting that a maximum protection was already obtained before in low iron condition. We also looked at mitochondria, which is a key actor for iron homeostasis, but didn't observe any modification of two proteins that contain iron sulfur cluster, aconitase 2 and SDHB, and normal mitochondrial ferritin, suggesting that there is a normal iron amount into the mitochondria. We then looked at the transferrin recycling in RepS1 fibroblast. The cells were incubated for 30 minutes with TF-RED, and then they were washed and fixed at different times. In control cells and RepS1 cells, at T0, the TF signal, transferrin signal, was similar in both cells. Then, in control cells, as you can see here, there is a progressive decrease of the transferrin signal that correspond to transferrin recycling. However, in RepS1 fibroblast, there is a delay in the transferrin recycling, and there is accumulation of the transferrin signal in the vicinity of the nucleus, even after 10 minutes, when transferrin was completely recycled in control cells. Therefore, RepS1 fibroblasts are characterized by a delay of the transferrin recycling. Based on this result, we therefore decided to study other fibroblasts from patients with different NBIA gene mutations, namely PONC2, PLE2G6, C19ORF12, IFE2H, QUAT, and we also included the RepS1 fibroblasts in this study. We first look at the iron content in these cells, and here you can see that in low iron condition. The iron content is relatively similar to what we observe in herpes 1 fibroblast. It's either similar to control cells or slightly increased. But when we incubated the cells in high iron condition, plus FAC, we observed obviously an increase of iron in control cells, but a major increase in all NBIA fibroblasts at the same level as RPS1. Indeed, NBIA fibroblasts have a 10 to 30 fold increase of iron compared to control that have only an 8 fold of iron content. So this shows that NBIA fibroblasts seem to be unable to limit iron uptake. Again, as in herpes 1 fibroblast, we look at the transferrin recycling in this NBI fibroblast and observe for all of them a delay in the transferrin recycling, showing that abnormal transferrin recycling is a generic feature in NBI fibroblasts. We then study the iron homeostasis, first looking at the post-transfusional regulation. Transferrin receptor mRNA was always decreased in high iron condition in all NBIA fibroblasts, and ferritin messenger was always increased, suggesting, demonstrating that the post-transcriptional regulation of iron homeostasis, TFR1 and ferritin, was completely normal in NBIA fibroblasts. We then looked at the are different proteins involved in iron homeostasis in NBIA fibroblasts. In low iron condition, iron-responsive proteins 1 and 2 are in similar level in control and patient's fibroblasts. And ferritin were slightly increased in NBIA fibroblasts, suggesting or reflecting the iron overload. In high iron condition, IRP1 and IRP2 here decreased in control fibroblast, and TFR also decreased to limit iron uptake, and ferritin increased to store the iron. In patients' fibroblasts in high iron condition, IRP1 and IRP2 also decreased, and ferritin increased for iron storage. However, TFR1 failed to decrease here. That could be related to the iron overload. Therefore, this concomitant increase of ferritin and transferrin receptor is paradoxical, as stored iron could decrease the iron uptake by decreasing the transferrin receptor here that is clearly not decreased in high iron condition. We then question whether the increased steady state level of TFR in NBIA fibroblast was related to accumulation of TFR at the cell membrane. And for that, we perform imaging flow cytometry using Amnis image stream. And as you can see here, we observed an accumulation of transferrin receptor at the periphery of the membrane, and the signal was clearly more important in control in patients compared to control. Therefore, all NBIA fibroblasts we studied are characterized by a cell membrane TFR1 accumulation. So we observed that in this NBIA fibroblast, we had abnormal transferrin and transferrin recycling receptor recycling. We have increased transferrin receptor amount. I didn't have time to show you, but we also observed abnormal transferrin receptor degradation, but completely normal transferrin receptor post-transcriptional regulation. This suggests the existence of a novel, non-canonical transferrin receptor post-translational regulation. Actually, this post-transcriptional regulation was the only known regulation for iron homeostasis. But indeed, a post-translational transferrin receptor modification has been described long time ago in 1990, but was completely forget since this time. And this modification is a palmotilation that occurs on cysteine 62 and cysteine 67. And mutation of these two cysteines result in a decreased transferrin receptor palmitoylation, increased TFR1 internalization, increased iron entry and iron overload, feature that we exactly observed in NBIA patients. Considering that acetyl-CoA is a sole donor of acetyl groups for acetyltransferase, we hypothesized that PONC2 and CRAT mutations that result in coenzyme A synthesis deficiency could be related to decreased palmitoylation. Therefore, we measure the palmitoylation of transferrin receptor by fatty acyl exchange chemistry in PONC2 and CRAT fibroblast, and it is observed a decrease of the TFR1 palmitoylation. And incubation with coenzyme A of these cells improves the transferrin receptor palmitoylation, suggesting that coenzyme A defect is related to deficient palmitoylation of transferrin receptor. But interestingly, we also observed a transferrin receptor palmitoylation defect in other NBIA, and the more important defects were observed in C19ORF12 and PLATO-G6 fibroblasts. Artesunate is known to induce transferrin receptor palmitoylation and to reduce the TFR1 at the cell surface level. Therefore, we treated these cells with artesunate, and this results in an increased palmitoylation of the transferrin receptor. There is several data that are consistent with a TFR1 palmitoylation defect in NBI. Metabolic profiling of PONC2 fibroblasts showed a decrease in palmitic acid. Drosophila model with PONC deficiency have decreased histone and tubulin acetylation. CoA-C fibroblasts have decreased acetyl and total coenzyme A. We observe that CRAT fibroblasts have a defect of palmitate beta oxidation. And E-PLATO mouse have a defect also in palmitate beta oxidation. FA2H encode a fatty acid hydroxylase that allows to transform fatty acid in hydroxy fatty acid. And finally, we do the hypothesis that RAPS1 mutation, by modulating the TFR1 traffic, will reduce its TFR1 palmitoylation, as most of the acid palmitoyl transferases are located on the Golgi membrane. All these NBIA genes are ubiquitously expressed, and it should be now interesting to know if TFR1 palmitoylation defect also occur in brain of NBIA patients. Palmitoylation consists of a covalent attachment of palmitate to specific cysteine via two ester bonds. This will modify the lipophilicity of the protein and therefore will regulate the protein trafficking, stability, and their localization in the cells. Palmitoylation is catalyzed by palmitoyl acyl transferases and depalmitoylation by acyl protein thioesterases. There is at least 20 palmitoyl transferases in humans, sometimes with specificity for substrate recognition. What is very important to know is that palmitoylation is a very rapid and reversible postnatal modification that regulates the protein localization. And transferrin, the half-life of transferrin receptor is more than 24 hours, and the half-life for its recycling is around 60 minutes. This means that transferrin receptor will recycle more than 100 times and will have several cycles of acetylation and deacetylation. Whereas the transferrin receptor post-transcriptional downregulation in high iron condition can take several hours, a rapid regulation by palmitoylation could be a rapid modulation of cellular iron, and this mechanism is defective in NBIA that could explain the iron accumulation. So we have now identified that PONK2 mutations, CRAT, C19orf12, FA2H, PLA2G6, and RepS1 mutations result in TFR1 palmitoylation defect, that we hypothesized is a common pathway that results in iron accumulation. Whether or not other gene mutations also result in defective TFR1 palmitoylation will be interesting to study. So now we have identified a novel, this novel TFR1 palmitoylation defect in several NBIA fibroblasts. We have added a supplementary level of complexity to these disorders. Indeed, the same gene mutations can result in various dysfunctions. For example, PONK2 mutations is expected to reduce the coenzyme A synthesis, and differs studies on mouse and animal models and cellular models have also shown that PONK2 deficiency also results in mitochondrial defect, in abnormal lipid metabolism, in decreased histone and tubulin acetylation, in TFR1 palmitoylation defect, maybe also other proteins, and iron overload. And I'm sure that all these defective pathways are involved in the clinical manifestation of the patients. So if we have added a novel level of complexity of these disorders, we have also identified a novel target for the treatment of NBIA. Until now, treatments aim to decrease the seizures, the dystonia of the patients, but the progressive identification of gene of NBIA allows to depict new targets. A first target, of sure, is the coenzyme A synthesis defect. Pantetin is transformed in pantethein and can be phosphorylated to give phosphopantethin. And there is several studies showing that pantethein can be useful for NBIA patients. In a Drosophila PONK model, pantethein has been shown to rescue the coenzyme A synthesis defect, to reverse the mitochondrial defect, to reduce the oxidative stress, and to enhance the locomotor abilities of the fly. In a mouse PONK2 knockout model, pantethein increased the oxygen consumption in brain mitochondria of this mouse and improved the motor dysfunction and neurodegeneration that appear when mouse have a ketogenic diet. In HEC 293 cells knocked down for PONK2, pantethein rescued the mitochondrial activity and rescued also the defect of acetylation and tubulin histones. Pantethein is used for the treatment of hyperlipoproteinemia and dyslipidemia with no adverse effect. Unfortunately, pantethein is not able to cross the blood-brain barrier. It will be difficult to use it as a treatment for NBIA patients. Fosmet pantothenate is also a precursor of coenzyme A, and it has been shown that in human neuroblastoma cell with a knockdown of PONK2, fosmethampenate increased the coenzyme A level and the tubulin acetylation. Fosmetpantothenate crossed the broadband barrier, and efficacy and safety study of fosmetpantothenate is currently ongoing in PECAN patients. It has been recently shown that cells can obtain coenzyme A from the extracellular medium. Indeed, coenzyme A can be converted extracellularly by ectonucleotide pyrophosphatase in phosphopantethein, and this phosphopantethein can then cross the cell membrane to be converted in coenzyme A and to be used as a precursor of coenzyme A. So treatment of iPS-derived neurons with PONK2 mutations reduce the neural loss. There is a significant recovery of the electrophysiological activity that was defective. There is a normal ROS level after the treatment and increased mitochondrial activity. Another obvious target is the iron accumulation, and deferiprone, which is a membrane permanent chelator, able to shuttling chelated iron from cell through transferrin, is already used for the treatment of other diseases with iron overload, such as hemochromatosis and thalassemia. Pecan patients have been treated with deferiprone that sometimes show a clear reduction of globus of iron in globus pallidus and had a mild effect on the clinical status of the patients. And actually, there is two or three clinical trials that have been done on deferiprone for Pecan patients, but the results are not yet published. Other patients with NBIA also had the treatment with deferiprone, but sometimes this deferiprone decreased the iron accumulation, sometimes had a slight effect on the clinical condition, but should be also interrupted in some patients because worsening of the clinical symptoms. And finally, the last target is the transferrin receptor palmitoylation. We have shown that artesunate improved the transferrin receptor palmitoylation, and we have indirectly measured the iron content by studying the ferritin content after treatment of artesunate. And as you can see here, NBIA patients treated with artesunate decrease that ferritin steady set level, suggesting a decrease of the iron content in these cells. Artesunate is a derivative of artemisinin that is extracted for Artemisia annua and is used for as an antimalarial drugs for very long time. And several million people receive artemisinin with very few adverse effects. Artesunate is also used as an anti-cancer drug, as it induces iron-dependent cell death. Artesunate is able to cross the blood-brain barrier and therefore represents a good drug for the treatment of NBIA. In conclusion, we have identified two novel genes of NBIA. We have found that NBIA fibroblasts have iron overload when grown in high iron condition. This is due to delayed transferrin recycling and abnormal transferrin recycling degradation. So we can therefore consider that NBIA is not only a metabolic disease, but also a disease due to abnormal transferrin receptor palmitoylation, and this represents a post-translational and intracellular trafficking disease. And we also observe that we also know that TFR1 palmitoylation is a new target for NBIA, but also for other diseases associated, more frequent diseases associated with iron accumulation, such as Parkinson's disease and Alzheimer's disease. And finally, I would like to thank the people who were involved in this study, especially Anthony Drecourt, a PhD student who did most of the work, and I thank you for your attention.